Good morning, everyone. Welcome to English service. Let's start off with the collect.
As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. Knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
Today's call to worship is taken from Psalm chapter 40, verses 1 to 5. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to worship today and pour out ourselves before you. We pour out our sins, our worries, our praises of thanks, and anything else on our minds. I pray that we would all come to trust you in our lives today, and that we would resist the temptation of the proud, and that we would stay humble. I pray that we would listen to you as you have listened to us, Lord, and today or in our weeks, Lord. I pray that you would keep everyone safe from the snow and from sickness. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Good morning, everyone. Let's all rise and praise our God together. Praise is rising.
Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Broken lives are your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Simply come, longing just to bring something that is worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, though the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless word, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, though the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it, but it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
You may be seated. This morning I go to the retreat again in A&W, and I read the Bible. I come across with one verse I want to share with you, and then we pray. The verse is from Proverbs 19, verse 23. It said, "The fear of the Lord leads to life, and whoever has its rest satisfied." So it's talk about life. I don't know whether you have life or you don't have a life. You have to have a life, but not just a life that you are surviving, but you have to have a life that you only can get a life that is like when you are fear of the Lord. And also it said, and whoever has it rest satisfied. So I want to ask one more question about yourself. Like, are you satisfied? are you satisfied? And then you may say, it depends on what kind of satisfaction you want to ask. But you have to ask yourself, is your life satisfied inside you? Anything you are still long for? Do you have more you want, or you want to have our God? If we have God, we have everything. If you fear of the Lord, you will have a life. And I don't know about your life, but we come to a church, it's not just want to find a friend. We come to a church, it's not just because my parents asked us to come. We come to the church, it's really to seek God and really to know the meaning of life. How is your life? I want to invite you to close your eyes and you pray to God. And then I have a closing prayer. No matter what you want to pray to God, our God, about the Bible, about your life, about something that is like you still have some desire on beside our God. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you. We come to you as a broken person because we have so much sin, so much sinful nature inside us. We long for so many things other than you. We long for different things in this world. And those things cannot satisfy our soul, cannot satisfy our life. Only you, Lord. You teach us today through the scripture about like to fear you. Lord, maybe we fear so many things. When we are thinking about fear, when we're thinking about worries, there are so many things around us. But one thing we may forget is to really fear of you. And you said, fear of the Lord, we have life. We want that life. We want that abundant life live in us. We want that freedom of life live in us. We want a life that without worries and without really that those terrify or things that happen around us. We really want the peace, the joy, and love will satisfy our heart. Help us, Lord. Maybe we did something wrong. Maybe you are not happy about. But Lord, you always ask us to come to you. When we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. And you always ask us to confess our sin. If we have commit sin, Lord, help us and forgive our sin. Lord, help us to confess all our sin before you. And let us to fear of you. And let us to have that abundant life in us. Father, we thank you. And in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
I need you.
I need you.
may be weak.
I may be weak, but your spirit is strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Cause I may be weak, but your spirit is strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say. That you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life.
Amen.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Luke chapter 8, verses 40 to 56. Now, when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house, because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. As Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. This is the word of the Lord.
All right, good morning, church, and happy new year. Since it's still January, I still feel I'm able to say that. Yes. Thank you for inviting me back today to just share with you what's been on my heart and what God has placed upon my heart about this passage. Just a show of hands before we start. Since it's a new year and everybody loves to make New Year resolution, who here has made a New Year resolution this year so far? Nobody? Some? Well, keep your hands up. I want to see. I've read some statistics that I want to see if it's valid or not. Okay, who here is still following their New Year resolution? Oh, some more hands go up now. Nice. Okay, well, based on statistics, what I've read is that 80% of people who make a New Year resolution actually stop following it in the beginning of February. Like, I know myself, I wanted to just work out and just kind of be more fit. I don't think I even got to the point of beginning. I think I made one green smoothie and then I kind of just stopped after that one day. And it's, even though it's often difficult to be in line and keep track
and stay focused and disciplined on New Year resolution, it's still good because growth can't really be seen at times, but it can only be measured. So if we make New Year resolution, then we can actually kind of measure our growth. And so I work with Urban Promise. I kind of shared before, and I work with after school, kids in after school program in Toronto Community Housing, just by Kennedy and Ellesmere. And so we do a lot of after school program. We do March break camps and we do summer camps. And this year, what I want to challenge kids on is for them to set goals for themselves. And part of it is to help them with literacy and mathematics. So we talk about sight words, and we have goals set of how to do coding with them and digital art. And when I ask them, like, oh, what? And I want to ask kids, they're like ages from 4 to 10. And I ask them, like, what kind of goals or New Year resolution do you have for yourself? And some of the kids says, oh, you know, I want to be better at basketball. That's a really legit one. Some people says, oh, I have a YouTube channel. I want to have more followers when I stream. And some people says, oh, my long-term goal is to get rich. And typically all our resolution kind of falls under these three categories of strength, wealth, and fame. And if you have one of them, it's pretty good. You're pretty set in life. You're pretty well off in life. And if you have two, that's even better. If you have wealth and fame, you're like a celebrity, and that's like a good place that you're kind of secure in the societal standing. If you have all three, then you're like kind of top of the food chain, kind of like top echelon or the 0.01% in the world. And if you think about it, if you have all three, the world is kind of at your feet. You have access to places, you have access to connections with people, you have access to different opportunities, and life seems limitless. But if you have none, and we talk about that, if you have all three, that's 0.01. So like majority of us, and a lot of us, and especially people I work with, families I work with, they don't have necessary wealth, strength, or fame, then times are a struggle. And we see that with schooling, with kids, especially with community that's under-resourced, how kids are falling behind because they weren't able to access adequate resource to do online learning. So they kind of had a whole year off from school when other kids excelled. Food scarcity, the cost of living has just gone way up. Like a head of lettuce costs $8. A spring of onions, green onions, was like $4, $4. And it's insane, and it's much cheaper to eat junk food. And so times are a struggle. And we talk about how having all these three things, these three categories of wealth, strength, and fame gives you VIP access to a lot of places. And here in this passage, it gives us a glimpse of what it means to access the kingdom of God. And we think of clubs and different people, important people, politicians, people empowering the world, and we rank it against the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven is pretty up there. And here we have two people that encounters Jesus, and they're on different opposite spectrum of social standings, and how they approach Jesus is the same way. And so through this passage, we're gonna look at three things. We're going to talk about how the way in which we approach Jesus, the way in which Jesus responds to them and us, and how do we cultivate this lifestyle of faith. And so looking at the scripture, it starts off with talking about Jairus. And Jairus, there was a very simple introduction. He is a synagogue leader, a ruler in the synagogue. And nothing needs to be said more. This guy has strength. He has a bunch of followers. If he is a ruler, that means he has a lot of strength because he has a lot of influence in his circle. He has wealth. It talks about him having tons of servants that would come and do his work. And that he has a household full of different people. So he has wealth, he has a place, he has strength, and he has fame. He, as a religious leader, he has everybody in town would probably know him, that they would go to the temple and he would be the person that they meet. And this man who has everything is encountered, and Luke here contrasts it with this old lady. And this old lady has none of it. And she is in the opposite, direct opposite standing of Jairus. This old lady, we're told that she had this ailment, this illness that makes her bleed for 12 years, that slowly drains her life away. She spends her money trying to see different physicians, to see different doctors to get healed, but they were of no effect. Instead of getting better, she got worse. And not only worse, now she's broke. And she has no fame. She's a societal outcast. She's a societal outcast. And back then, in Jewish laws, there were a lot of things that makes you unclean. I'm not sure if you heard of this game called Manhunt that I used to play with kids. I play with kids a lot. And it reminds me of Manhunt. And it is what it is, it's kind of like a variation on tag, where someone is it, they touch somebody, and instead of that person being it, they both become it. And the whole point of the game is to stay alive until everybody is captured, where you pass on, you tag somebody and they get kind of infected. And so kind of, and it reminds me of how Jewish law is kind of set up. Because in Leviticus 15, it talks about just different regulations of what makes you clean and unclean. And in Leviticus 15 specifically, it talks about what to do with people that are bleeding. And if you read that, it's a whole chapter long. It talks about if men are having discharge, that or men and women, whatever they touch, if you touch that thing, you're unclean. If you sit on a chair that someone was bleeding, sat on, that makes you unclean. If you, whatever they touch, a clay pot, you have to smash that pot right away. So there is this stigma of what this woman has, and it made her an outcast. And what we see here, and they both encounter Jesus the exact same way. It doesn't matter if they were of high social standing or a nobody, they still encountered Jesus. They still approached Jesus, and they had one thing in common, and it was their faith. It was not their riches. It was not Jairus' money that can buy his way into a meeting with Jesus. It's not his strength that he pushed his way through. It's not your popularity. It's not who you know, how you're connected to who and who, such and such, to get access to the kingdom. And if we think about relating to our days, it's not about how much wealth we've accumulated. It's not how strong, how much muscle mass we have. It's not about our popularity. It's not about who we know or who we are parents of or which famous Christian we know, that we get access to God, or we know God, or enter his kingdom. It's by faith that Jairus had faith, and he approached Jesus. But on the flip side, though, we got to be careful. And it's not the opposite that grants you access to the kingdom. It's not poverty. It's not weakness. It's not discrimination. It's not being an outcast that directly grants you favor with the king. It's also faith. Mind you, in the Bible, it talks about God is near to the brokenhearted, those who has broken and contrite heart. And I'm not saying that it's not a bad thing, but it's not the thing that Jesus looks for. Being poor in spirit, having a broken and contrite heart sets you up to have this need, to have faith, to seek someone who can help. And so this woman and Jairus has the same faith that allowed them to approach Jesus. And in Hebrews 11:6, it talks about how without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's impossible to approach God without faith. It's not by works, but it's by faith alone. And hence, when we look at this faith then, what does this faith look like? And right here, not only do they share the same faith, they share the same quality of faith. Both are desperate, and they are both at the end of their ropes. But how they reach this point also represents two extremes. For Jairus, who had a daughter of 12 years old, and I think you only kind of feel this as a parent. I have three kids. I have two daughters and a son. And what you value before you're a parent and what you value after you're a parent is completely different. And when you're a parent, you kind of put all your hopes and dreams onto your kids, and that if they are successful, if they have joy, that brings you joy. It brings you joy to see them happy, and you wish for them for their own success, much more so than your own. That there's sacrifices made, and yeah, there is a lot more selflessness in caring, and what you value is different when you're a parent. And here we see that Jairus, it states that he has his only daughter of 12 years, someone who for the past 12 years he has been pouring his life into, that all his hopes and dreams were bound by his daughter, and that life is about to come to an end. And so he's at a point of desperateness, he's at a point of hopelessness, that what's going to happen next? In Hamilton, the famous musical, there's one song called Uptown, and it talks about how Hamilton, after he experienced his loss of his oldest son, Philip, sang this song, and it talks about this pain of only parents can experience, that losing a child is this unimaginable experience. And I think, and makes you desperate. It changes your life, and makes an interruption to all your plans, your hopes, and your dreams. Everything kind of just stops abruptly. And that was it for Jairus. And on the flip side, when we see the old woman, she was also at a point of desperateness. She was also at a point of hopelessness, but it wasn't so sudden. It was also 12 years. For the 12 years that the little girl was born and alive, this woman suffered shame for 12 years. Can you imagine? 12 years of having no friends, 12 years of being outcast in your community and exiled, where everybody you know doesn't want to associate themselves with you. Doesn't say if she has a family, but if she does, she would cook, no one would eat her food. That her husband would not touch her because that would make him unclean. And the loneliness that she must have felt for the 12 years leading up to that point must be unbearable. And in each of their circumstances, as they reached out, Jesus met them where they're at. And if you look at with me in the passage, in verse 45, Jesus says, "Who touched me?" That's a strange thing to ask, because everyone denied it, and even Peter, who was really surprised, like, "What are you talking about, Jesus? Can't you see? You're pushing in the crowd. Crowds are swarming against you. Everybody's touching you, and you're asking, 'Who touched me?'" "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." Well, Jesus replied, like, "Well, somebody touched me, because I know power has gone out of me." So what was Jesus trying to say? Does Jesus not know? Of course Jesus knew. And that was for the sake of the woman. You see, the woman who probably the whole town knows about her, of how she is with the ailment, and she has been avoided, alienated. Jesus comes down and reaches down and says to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." Just sit on that for a moment and think. The woman who is so ashamed of herself that she feels she's completely unloved, that she can't even go to the temple to ask for forgiveness or even worship for the past 12 years because of her bleeding, that she feels that she's forgotten. And in that circumstance, Jesus reached down and calls her his daughter. How powerful is that? And your faith has healed you. Go in peace. And for Jairus, who laid down his pride, his identity, and his standing, approaches Jesus the same way. Think about it. A synagogue ruler would come and beg Jesus for help and healing. Think of all the relationships that he had to break when all his other colleagues would be challenging Jesus and questioning Jesus. Here Jairus is approaching Jesus with faith, knowing that he somehow can do a miracle to help his daughter. And Jesus also met him where he's at, and Jesus responds positively because of his faith. In Matthew 11:29, of all the Gospels, in all four Gospels, Jesus reveals his heart in this one place. In Matthew 11:29, it says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest in your soul." And Jesus' heart is gentle and lowly, and he responds positively to you when you come to him. And I'm not sure where you guys are at right now, this day. And if you think about Jairus and the old lady as being two extremes of social standing, where one is top dog and one is just bottom of the food chain, we fall somewhere in the middle. And I think Luke sets it up so that we can all relate that no matter if you are at the top of your game, that you're the most important person in this world, or you're the nobody, that you can still somehow relate in this story because Jesus responds to you, your faith, the same way. Whether you are experiencing hopelessness that's very sudden, that you might have lost your job, or death in the family, and you feel like there is no hope and that it's the end, or your life has just been mundane and life has just been chipping you away slowly for the past while, and then you feel like life has brought you no joy and you're at a place of hopelessness, Jesus is there to meet you where you're at. Jesus responds to your faith. And it's important to know that he doesn't just come and responds to your faith in a loving manner. He's also reversing the Jewish system. When we talked about how the Jewish system was set up, everything a sinner or unclean person touched makes it unclean. Jesus, on the opposite, when he touched an unclean sinner, Christ did not become unclean. The sinner became clean. And what he's doing and demonstrating all throughout his ministry is that he's giving back people's the undeserved their humanity. He called the outcast his daughter, restoring her in front of her community to let them know that she no longer has the ailment, restoring her status as a member of the community. So in John Bunyan, one famous writer who wrote most famous for The Pilgrim's Progress, he also wrote tons of other books. And he, as a Puritan, Puritans love to just focus on one verse and just kind of write a whole book on it. And so he comments on John 6:37, and he wrote this as he described the heart of Jesus towards sinner. And in John 3:6, 6:37 says this, Jesus declares, All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. And there's a lot of theological promises in that. It says all that everybody that the Father sets his eye, when the Father sets his eyes on the sinner, that sinner is delivered, deliverance is certain. That the Father freely gives, that we don't have to barter, we don't have to haggle, we don't have to negotiate with God for this. And that it will come. That God's saving promise is never thwarted, it's never frustrated, his plan can never be upset. And whoever comes, it says, that we are not forced to come. It's not a dictatorship that we're forced into God's love, but we come to him because we see his beauty. We see our brokenness, and we see what life he has to offer. And most importantly, it's not coming to a religion. It's just come to me. We're coming to a person. Not words of good news, but it's a person. And it's saying that whoever comes to Jesus says to him, I will never cast you out. And so John Bunyan in his book says this, this is the sum of all promises, that we as sinners, we kind of think of different ways to, based on our own experience, to reason, like, there's no way that God can love me. Like, if only God knows what I've done, there's no way that God can love me. And John Bunyan wrote this, but I'm a great sinner, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I'm an old sinner, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I'm a hard-hearted sinner, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I'm a backsliding sinner, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I have served Satan all my days, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. I have sinned against the light, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I have sinned against mercy, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. But I have no good thing to bring with me, say you. I will never cast you out, says Christ. This promise was provided to answer all objections. So what objection do we have left? What can we say that grace can't cover? That what Jesus accomplished on the cross that can't cover over? And so as we think about this, what does this faith actually look like then? What would it look like in our lives as we think about this coming year? How can we practice such a faith that draws near to Christ? And often when I was young, I was often think that faith is this myth, this power that can be tapped into. Once you have faith, it kind of automatically pops up, like this passive ability that once you have it, it comes up in times of trouble. Just a few verses before this, Jesus teaches his disciples and teaches us that faith is something that can be cultivated. Faith is something that can be practiced and exercised and built stronger. Just a few verses earlier in this chapter, when the disciples and Jesus were out at sea, and the disciples were freaking out because a storm is coming. Like, Jesus, do you not care? Like, wake up, we're going to drown. Aren't you going to save us? And Jesus calmly responds to them. He doesn't say, you lack faith, you have little faith. But he says, where is your faith? That faith is something to be put into practice. And as you put it more into practice, it becomes easier to be at a state of dependency. During COVID, I got into biking. I'm not sure if you guys like cycling or not, but I just got into it. I haven't biked for a long time, so it was just getting back into it, and all my friends were doing it. And the following year, after I got the bike, a lot of my friends got these pedals, these clip-on shoes where it kind of doubles your power. They're all telling me, oh, man, if you want to go pro, if you want to go faster, you got to get these clip-ons. you're not only pushing down on the pedal, but as you're coming up, you're like merged with the bike, that it pulls you up as well, that it pulls up the pedal as well. So you go literally twice as fast. And so I got it, thinking I'll probably be faster with it. But it was probably a really bad idea, because you have to kind of really learn how to use the bike at that point. That once you're clipped on, there's no way getting off unless you can teach your mind that you need to like slide your foot the right way in order to unclip. Otherwise, if you stop and you're clipped on, you fall with the bike. And I've fell so many times, and I still have not been successful. And it's really teaching about, and as you practice more, and you practice more and more, it becomes muscle memory that you kind of, your body just recalls. I think it's similar to faith, that as you place your trust in Jesus, as you place your trust and depend on him, and you're, when you're at a place of emptiness and desperateness, and you trust that he is everything that you need, that he is enough, that as you practice this more and more, it becomes easier. It becomes easier to be at a place of trust. But it doesn't feel, but I don't want to promise you that it feels good. It doesn't feel good being in that place of trust, because each and every step as you learn greater dependence on God, you realize that he is so much more than we can ever imagine. And so each level that he places, once you kind of graduated from like placing your faith in him one time, he pushes the boundary that much higher to tell you to place your trust in him even further. And so, when we talk about faith, what does a faith look like? I want to just kind of leave you with two things. It's about trusting and treasuring. Trusting and treasuring Jesus. So in order to be saved, to be in Christ, we must trust in him, right? So that is that we must come to a point where we see that all our works, all our good works means nothing before God, that we are unclean, that we are just devoid of righteousness, and that our unrighteous act can't ever measure up to the high standard he has, that we are just in need of a Savior to help us, and we place our trust in Christ, who is able to be our perfection, who is able to be our righteousness, who went onto the cross and took on our shame and guilt. And so we place our trust in him that he's able to do all these things. And he demonstrates this here by healing the sick and raising the dead, that there's nothing that he can't do. And yet we also not only trust, but we also treasure him. So when Christ, when God in Christ does this for a wretch like me, when we think about what he has done on the cross for someone like me, how can we not be my heart's treasure? How can he not be the affection of our heart and desire? And to treasure Christ is to hear the Father say to his Son, "This is my child, my Son. With you, I am well pleased." And then repeat it immediately back to him, saying, "This is my Savior. With him, I am well pleased." And we can see both of these come together perfectly in many places in the Bible of trusting and treasuring. But one example I want to leave with you is Psalm 28. And it says this: "The Lord is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. My heart exults, and with my song I give thanks to him." And just notice how the psalmist trusts in God and treasures him. This exulting is worshiping, rejoicing, delighting, and being moved by just Almighty God. And this is why he continues on to brag about the work of God in the life of his people, that it causes him to delight in God and how he's working in his people. And in verse 7, 8 and 9, it says, "The Lord is the strength of his people. He is the saving refuge of his anointed. Oh, save your people and bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forever." Biblical faith has always looked the same. We look away from ourselves and we look to God, who has revealed himself, made promises, acted powerfully, and showcase his almightiness, and he won our loyalty. And so as we, and it's a verbal challenge for us all, is that this year, may we demonstrate and place ourselves in a situation where we can practice this faith so that we place our faith in Christ, we believe, and we treasure, and we trust in God. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you that as we start this new year, we understand that you are the God that's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And we rejoice in that truth when all things seem uncertain, that you are unchanged and you are faithful. And as we think about, Lord, of all the circumstances in our lives, may your Holy Spirit reveal in us just the of just how much we need you, that we may be feeling, there may be things that we put in place to make us feel secure, that's a false sense of security. Or maybe we are in a position that we are in desperate need and we are at the end of our ropes. But I pray that wherever we are at, that Jesus, Lord Jesus, that you'll come and meet us, and that you will come and restore us and allow us to experience your love and hear your words of affection towards us. And I pray that as we come and live each day and fix our eyes on you, teach us what it means to be faithful, teach us what it means to have faith, teach us what it means to trust and just treasure you as our all in all. So I thank you and pray all this in your son's precious name. Amen.
Thank you for the message and for the reminder, the lesson that of who Jesus is and how he loves us and how he responds to us. I also think back to like this morning in our Sunday school, we were also talking about having faith and taking that step to seek God and how God promises in Matthew 7 that if we seek him, we will find him. And I think, we first have to, like you said at the end of the sermon, how we have to recognize who we are as sinners and how we need a savior, and then we can take that step of faith to find him, and he will be there for us, and Jesus is our savior. So I hope that this responsive song for today can be like our prayer to ask God to give us faith and to give us more opportunities to practice our faith and to grow closer to him. So let's all rise and sing this together.
My heart and break me apart. I need
Let's recite the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Let's receive the benediction by faith. Let's pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated.
Now would usually be the time for offering. So if you have offering, you can send it through Interact e-transfer to inquiry@tcmc.ca, or you can send the check to the church office. Make sure to deliver the offering to church office during office hours, and make sure you call prior to your delivery. Next is Discipleship Bible Study. Online Bible study occurs every first Saturday of the month. And so we'll have a Bible study this coming Saturday, February 4th at 8:30 p.m. Here's the Zoom ID is 816-1972-6260. And the passcode is 134540. Please come and join us and read the scripture together. The TCMC 40th anniversary. So to celebrate the 40th anniversary of TCMC, there will be a logo design competition that is for everyone to showcase their creativity for praise and thanksgiving. Please submit your design to inquiry@tcmc.ca and explain your design concept. If you have any questions, please contact Elaine Chu or Josephine Fu. Teens Conference. Teens Conference is coming up during March break. On March 13 and 14, it will be for grades 7 to 9. And on March 15 and 16, it will be for grade 9 to 12. They will all be in person at RH3C. Registration is now open, so please visit afccanada.org/TC for online registration. Please come, you may or may not see a familiar face. Alithia Retreat. Alithia will be having the retreat at Fairhaven Bible Conference and Retreat Center, Fair Glen, from Friday, February 24th, 6 p.m., to Sunday, February 26th, to 1 p.m. The early bird price is $150. After the early bird deadline, it'll be $170. So the early bird deadline will be February 5th, 2023. All payments can be given to Aiden Lee, but please have your parents fill in the consent form found in the English WhatsApp group chat. Those are all the announcements, and here are the worship responsibilities for next week. After a moment of silence, service will be concluded.